Egyptian. Moses panics, and they tell us for a while in another version of the story down in Acts, if you go to read it later on, not in Exodus, they tell us that Moses gives up his rights to the Egyptian throne. He no longer wants to be known as the princess's son, and he chooses to live with his people in slavery. And then when Pharaoh really started coming after him, he runs away to a land called Midian. When he gets there, he saves a group of women who are being harassed. And when the women go home to tell their father what had happened, the eldest daughter says, "An Egyptian saved us." And I thought this was interesting because we're in Exodus 2 verse 19, where Zipporah says, "An Egyptian man," verse 2 verse 19, thank you. And they answered, "An Egyptian rescued us from the shepherds. He even drew water for us and watered the flocks." So it's interesting because at this point, Moses had already decided that he was going to side with his Hebrew brothers. He was having, I imagine, some sort of major identity crisis at 40 years old, where he's at the height of his power in Egypt, right? He's next in line to the throne in Egypt, and something in him is saying, there's a part of me I still don't know. There's a part of me I still need to explore. So he decides to go out and find his people. Now, when they say Moses goes out to find his people, he's not going from here to the parking lot or from here to across the street. If the palace is here and Moses is going to his own people, he's traveling to maybe Center City, Princeton, or he's traveling to maybe the Market Fair theater down there. Moses is really taking a trip, and this is an intentional trip to go and find his own people. When he gets there, he decides to say, he finds the Hebrew who's being beaten by an Egyptian, and he has to make a decision. Am I going to stand on the side of this Egyptian and say nothing, or am I going to stand on the side of this Hebrew who are my people and intervene? And there is no wrong or right answer here, because as an Egyptian prince, he has the right to say nothing and walk away. And as a Hebrew-born boy, he has the right to intervene for his people. So he decides to intervene for his people, therefore identifying himself as a Hebrew. But the problem was that when Moses got to Midian, just as in Egypt, who Moses appeared to be was at odds with who he was, or at the very least, who he wanted to be. So even though Moses had decided in his heart that he was Hebrew, everything about him on the outside identified him as an Egyptian. The way he walked, the way he talked, and even though he spent some time slaving with the slaves, he still stood out as an Egyptian. And I imagine that when he saved the women, the way he fought off the men probably made it clear that this was no Hebrew slave, this was a man who had military training back in Egypt. And so the story tells us that he has a son with Zipporah, he marries her and they have a son, and he names the son Gershom, which means foreigner in a foreign land. In Midian, Moses reached the height of his identity crisis. So much so that he couldn't do for his son what his Egyptian mother did for him when she took him into her home. What she did for him was tell him who he was. He'd been a foreigner in the Egyptian palace for his entire life. Then he became a foreigner, because I imagine, I don't know how many of you have family ties with people, or have people in your family who may be from different backgrounds and different cultures, but there's at some point where family members, especially the older ones, love to sit and tell you how you came to this family. Because, you know, you didn't come like the rest of us, you were brought to us, or you know, I gave birth to this child, but you, I took from so-and-so, and that's how you came to this family. And I imagine that Moses probably had similar experiences in the palace where once in a while they would let him know, you know, this, he's your brother, he's not really your brother, you know, like, the princess gave birth to him, but he took you from the Hebrews, and then we raised you, that's why you were with them for so long when you were younger. So he's been a foreigner for a very long time. And then he became a foreigner amongst his own people. For that brief period of time, he chose to suffer with them, and I'm sure he wasn't openly accepted there by his people, and now he found himself foreign to himself, and now he found himself foreign to himself in a foreign land, because he had no idea what Midian was. He didn't know who he was, and he didn't know who he belonged to. He felt like an outsider everywhere he went, and his identity crisis had become his identity. And so that's the legacy, the only legacy that he could give his son. Identity crisis meant. And it's a period of uncertainty and confusion in which a person's sense of identity becomes insecure, typically due to a change in their expected aims or roles in society. So do we agree that based on this definition, Moses was going through a major identity crisis in Midian? Only one person agreed. Two. I agree, it's my sermon, so we're just gonna take it. Okay. So he's now a foreigner in a foreign land. He was a foreigner all his time, all his life at home, and now he lives the next 30 to 40 years of his life in that identity crisis. In Midian, in the desert, becoming a shepherd, marrying Zipporah, and having two sons. Something I'm sure many of us struggle with. The story focuses on country and whether Moses is Egyptian or Hebrew, because that's how I connected with it the most. But our identity can be tied up in so much more. It could be religion, sexual orientation, parents that we never knew, that has got us stuck in an uncertainty and confusion. Sometimes even confusion, and I would even say guilt, over where you should fall and where you shouldn't fall. And if I were to go back to my example of being Haitian or Haitian American, I sometimes always feel guilty because I would go and work. I'm so determined to stay and work here in communities. I will go and travel to other countries and work in their communities. And sometimes I say to myself, should I move to Haiti and go work in Haiti as a Haitian American? If I've got all this training and I've got all this knowledge and all this education, should I go back to Haiti and come into that country and grow that country? So it's a guilt and a confusion that I identify with. I'm not sure about you. So Moses lives in that identity crisis for over 40 years until one day he sees a burning bush. And I'm not going to go into the story. If you want to read it, it's in Exodus 3, or you can watch the movie. There are several movies where they tell you about the burning bush. So Moses sees this burning bush. The bush is on fire, but it's not burning. And he goes up there to see what's going on. When he gets there, before he even has the opportunity to ask the voice who the voice is, or what the voice is, or what the street is, Exodus 3 verse 6 tells us that the voice identifies himself before Moses even has a chance to say hello. And the voice says, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. What Moses, I don't think, realized is, or at least what I think just happened, is that God identifies himself and in turn claims Moses and reveals his true identity. He says, he's essentially saying to Moses, you're a son of Abraham, you're a son of Isaac, you're a son of Jacob, which makes you a child of God, which makes you my child. And then he goes on to finally reveal to Moses, 80-something years later, his purpose, why he was born, why he's been going through all this. The problem was, however, that this is 30 or 40 years after Moses had taken that stance in Egypt and decided to save this Hebrew slave. So Moses, at that point, had given up on being anyone's savior. Moses, at that point, can't even fathom that he still has a purpose, that he can't even fathom that God is not here in front of me, God is claiming me, and God is saying, I'm finally going to tell you who you are and what you're meant to do in this world. And the Bible tells us that Moses was in so much disbelief, he even asked Jesus at one point, or the burning bush at one point, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? He was so consumed by this question of his identity that he did not even realize how perfect he was and has always been for this particular job. And they tell us that he was so unsure of his position and identity at this point that he even angered God because he kept saying, send someone else, God. It's not me. You have the wrong guy. I mean, I know we're going to do this 40 years ago. It's not 40 years later. Find someone else. So Moses did not realize how perfect he was for this position. He didn't realize that 40 years ago, when he was at the peak of his power and prestige, and perhaps even next enthroned to Egypt, when he saw that man and had compassion on him and made the commitment to work with his people, he was coming from a place of conviction. And he was coming from a place of conviction and confidence in God, something that he got from staying with his mother Because what Moses didn't realize was that at every point of his life where he felt he really didn't know where he belonged, and he felt he really didn't know his identity, he was actually exactly where God wanted him to be. You see, in every period of his life that Moses thought he was experiencing an identity crisis, he was actually right where God needed him to be for his development, for his purpose. Because as a child of God, your home, your country, your labels and titles are where and what God wants them to be at any point or moment in time. The times when he questioned and wondered the most about his identity turned out to be the most critical to preparing him for his purpose and what he was called to do. Moses had to go through a spiritual development if he was going to lead the people of Egypt. And that moment could not happen in the Egyptian palace because no one worshipped God in the Egyptian palace. So God took this little Hebrew boy that was supposed to die. He has the Egyptian princess adopt him. This way he's under protection and will not die. And then she gives Moses back to his mother, who spends the formative early years of his life in a Jewish household, learning the Jewish customs, learning about Jesus and his faithfulness and his promise to the Israelites. And because of this, Moses knew that the Jewish people were his people, and he knew that God would one day deliver them. This is not something he could have learned in the Egyptian palace. But he also had character enough to not be swayed or pulled down by the temptations that he would face in Egypt. And I mean, sinful temptations, the treasures of Egypt, because it takes a lot to give up being next in line to the throne to going to being a slave. It takes a lot of character, and that's something that he only could have learned while he was living with his people in the early years of his life. But God needed more than a godly man to leave Egypt. So Moses had to go through a social development. And he went through that social development in the palace in Egypt. At the time when the Egypt Empire was at its peak, there was no greater empire, no greater place to get knowledge, no greater place to be educated than in Egypt. And what better place to get the best education than in the Egyptian palace? They tell us that the cream of Egypt was poured into the cup of this prince named Moses. The Bible says that he was educated in all the wisdom of the Egyptians and was powerful in speech and action. This means that when Moses walked into a room, people stopped what they were doing to listen to what Moses was about to say. It means that the men stood up, they wanted to hang on to every word that Moses said, and the women probably fell. Maybe they stood it and they fell at the sight of Moses, who was probably also this great military hero. It means when he moved and he walked, he had a certain, the best thing that comes to my mind is he had a certain swag about him, for lack of a better term, that when he came in, you know, you wanted to be around Moses. You wanted to talk to Moses. But more importantly, he was learning how to give laws. He was learning how to govern a nation. Because if he was going to govern the people of Israel in the desert, we can't just have a godly man. We need someone who can put down the law, lay down the law, and make decisions and pass decrees to lead a nation of millions of people. We're not talking about Princeton-sized nation here. We're talking about Princeton city-sized nation. So God really needed a man who had training to do this. And that's what Moses was learning during his time in the palace. And Moses, at that point when he was 40 years old and went out to his people, probably thought he was in the prime time to go and save his people. But God said, no, not yet. I have a special development for Moses. After Moses spent 40 years in the Midian desert, he probably felt like such a failure. I mean, you have to think about it. To be next in line, to be a slave, and then be kicked out, and now you're herding sheep in the desert, in the sand, all day, every day, for 40 years. People used to stand up to hear, to listen and hang on to every word that you're saying, and now the people that listen to you are actually sheep that you're herding in the desert. He must have felt like a failure after 40 years, and he must have felt like his time was wasted. But what Moses again didn't realize was that these were not wasted years. God was teaching him valuable lessons in the desert. Because God needed a man who could persevere and always do the right thing. And he was learning that in the desert. I'm sure he had a lot of time to learn perseverance when you're being a shepherd for 40 years in the desert. God needed for Moses to let go of his power. He needed for Moses to learn that it would be God and not him who would deliver Israel. And God did not need his military powers. And even though God gave him the training, God needs to make sure that the power, the great power and station that Moses had amassed to wouldn't get in the way of the work he needed him to do. He needed to essentially break down Moses' ego so that he can work with Moses. He needed Moses to have complete confidence in him, which is something he may have struggled with if God used him as Pharaoh of Egypt. And lastly, God needed someone who could be practical. God knew that his people were going to spend a long time in the desert. So God needed a man who really understood the desert. God needed someone to know when it was coldest, when it was hottest, when it's a good time to walk, when it's a good time to rest. God needed someone who knew where the dangers were. God needed someone who knew where to find water when there was no water. So God needed someone who really understood this landscape where his people were going to dwell and live for years. And that's exactly what Moses was learning in the desert. You see, Moses' problem was not that he didn't know who he was, it's that he didn't know who he belonged to. When you don't know who you belong to, you don't know who you are. It's an incredible danger to live life without knowing who you are because you don't know why you matter outside of your achievements, your relationships, and you are not equipped to face great challenges in shifting environments. Moses felt like a failure after 40 years because in his mind, if he didn't save the people of Israel and he didn't become Pharaoh, I'm a failure. But he couldn't understand that God, the man he belonged to, had other plans for him. Like Moses, you will always feel like you're aimlessly wandering in some desert, regardless of how much power and status you have. You will struggle with this sense of self. Like Moses, you will always go looking for what defines you. This is why it was important for God to tell Moses who he was at the burning bush before he revealed his purpose to him. It was important for him to identify Moses as his own before he even gave him his purpose. Moses needed to come to terms that he was not Egyptian nor Hebrew. When it came down to it, he was a child of God, placed and moving around in opportune times where God needed him the most. As a product of our labels in today's society, many of us feel like we are just wandering aimlessly, hoping to belong somewhere. We're moving and we're moving well and we're accomplishing great things, but we haven't even begun to walk in our purpose yet. We have dreams and visions and goals that we can't quite define because we're still trying to answer the fundamental, basic question of who we are and to whom we belong. We're still stuck on the labels, and we're still trying to fit in. We're still trying to decide which boxes we're going to check off when we're filling out forms. And we're still trying to fit into places we don't belong. We're still trying to define ourselves and roll our own lives. You see, what Moses gave up when he killed that Egyptian was not power or riches. He gave up the right to rule and define himself. He gave up trying to be who he appeared to be on the outside, who society wanted him to be, and gave into his convictions. Convictions that made up the fabric of who he was. Convictions that set him up on a journey of finding his identity in Christ. Even when we feel God has forgotten us and is doing nothing, it's important to remember that he is always closer than we imagine, weaving together the fabric of who we are, moving aimlessly and easily through our lives, preparing us for the work he has called us to do. Galatians 2 verse 20, our second memory, it's our second memory verse, but it's not a part two of the sermon, don't worry. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Your true identity lies in your death to self. Just like Moses had to be stripped of his labels, titles, riches, accomplishments, and country, just like he had to be weakened and humbled in the desert so that all of his confidence was in God, we too need to give into Christ. And probably not by having to spend 40 years in the desert. I want to do it the easy way. We need to continually remind ourselves that we belong to Him and live only for His glory. And if you're at a place in your life where you feel like you're not moving and you're struggling with this issue of identity because you've fallen so far behind in the plans you had that you don't even remember who you used to be, let alone who you should be, remember that Moses fell from glory and spent 40 years in the Midian sand as God prepared him for the most iconic position in biblical history. Till this day, every Easter, the world tunes in to watch the story of Moses, a nameless boy born to Hebrew slaves, raised in the finest Egyptian palace, who became a lost shepherd in the Midian sand. Everyone at Easter, my grandmother has never missed an Easter since that movie came out on Sunday, where she doesn't watch the story of Moses and the Ten Commandments. God is still shaping you and molding you. And your current lesson might just be to stay where you are and become more and more like Jesus in your situation. Moses became more and more like Jesus in his situation. He went from being up there, the highest you could be in the time of Egypt, to being down there in the sand with the sheep every day for 40 years, to being stripped of everything, to being a shepherd, to eventually freeing his people. When we leave here today, we will no longer wander, W-A-N-D-E-R, aimlessly, or wander, W-O-N-D-E-R, where to belong or how to identify. We will no longer be products of names, identifiers, labels, adjectives, or discouraging remarks, products of things we could have done or have yet to do. We will no longer be the characteristics and titles we were given, glances and statements that judge us. We will no longer be stereotypes or be consumed by unrealistic expectations. We will no longer be conflicted by who we should be and what we should stand for. Instead, we will give up the power to define ourselves and let God do it for us. God wants to claim us. He wants to give us His identity, and we're going to let Him. Won't you let Him do it? Just a couple people, but that's okay. We're going to die to ourselves, give up our homes and countries, so that we can rise again with Christ. We're going to give in to Him and identify with Him, because once you identify with Christ, your identity crisis is resolved. Thank you.
Amen.
He's so amazing.
Thank you.
Father God, we want to thank you so much for being with us today, and thank you so much for letting your word be delivered without a glitch. Thank you so much for reminding us again that we belong to you, and only you, and only you can name us, identify us, change us, move us as you please. I want to thank you so much for that love. I want to thank you so much for that provision. I want to thank you so much for that protection. I want to thank you so much for giving us your identity. As we go out today into the world, help us remember what we went over here today. When we're faced with these challenges and we're faced with these decisions, help us remember that you've made plans for us already and we just need to give in. Bless our friends and family that could not be here with us today. Bless our kids who are downstairs and protect them, Lord, as they grow up and try to discover their identities. We ask you this not because we're worthy, but in the loving name of Jesus we pray.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.